They're men of skin with the got no hips. They're men of dicks with opinions. And now let's start the show.
You know what though? When we did, I did the one with Ash and Julian, and as I was doing it, we were like, because it was all Ash's equipment. They had just done boys Bible study. So then yeah. Ash was like, "We'll just record it on my stuff," and asked me if I wanted headphones, and I said, "No, why not? I'm gonna skip it this time." And as soon as I did, I realized I just don't even feel like I'm on a podcast.
It is weird. Yeah. It kind of, the headphones actually almost create like a simulation that you can better get into, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah, I definitely get that. I haven't listened to that one yet, actually.
Oh, wow. Shows we talk mad shit on you.
It came out when I was in like the fallow part of the country where you can't get the internet.
Yeah. Flyover states.
I mean, dude, not to get into tour shit. We already covered that last time. I definitely get flyover states now. Like, yeah. Why would anybody give a fuck about any state that's not California or New York?
Oh, my God. This podcast has changed us. Wow.
It is pretty wild, though, when you driving through them. Because we went northernly from Chicago to Denver. And that corridor of, like, Nebraska. Nebraska has cities, I guess. I'm just talking about Wyoming.
Yeah.
It's like a nothing state. Like, I don't know what you do there.
I think Kanye. That's it. He lives there.
So is Kevin Costner. I think it's like a place where rich...
Assholes
can retire and get a lot of bang for their buck.
Yeah,
maybe.
If you're like too much of an asshole, even for like Malibu or like the Upper East Side or something, you're like, no, I gotta be enough of an asshole for an entire empty state.
Right. I need to take what we gave to the native peoples back and buy a big ranch. I think the heat. I think I'm having allergies. Can you hear it?
Yeah, you sound a little.
I'm a little crunchy.
You sound like, yeah, you got some crunch.
Yeah. How are you with this heat?
This is not, well, heat isn't, I'm seasonal allergies, and this is not my season. My season is not the thaw, or not the go into winter, it's the thaw.
I see. Okay, so the coming out. I see. So the spring.
Spring.
Hay fever,
yeah.
Springtime sprig.
Yeah, the springtime sprig. Yeah, I'm a springtime sprinkler, a springtime sprite.
Oh, yeah. See, that's all terrible. I think I have, in California at least, I think I have post-rain allergies.
And that's just the weird chemicals that get washed up in the rain that have been sitting there.
Dude, and have you noticed an uptick in flies?
Have you noticed the uptick in mosquitoes?
So I have not, because the only thing in the world I'm not allergic to is mosquitoes.
Okay, I hate mosquitoes. I'm going to say it, controversial opinion.
Whoa.
Okay, don't at me, bro.
Whoa.
But mosquitoes, not a fan.
No, leave it at home.
And yeah, I went kind of nuts yesterday, and like, it was our air conditioner stopped working, or it had an issue, so then I was like, okay, then I'll just go sit outside, you know, mosquito problem. I went nuts, I went on Amazon, ordered like 15, I bought the mosquito bracelets, I got mosquito spray.
You got spray, tiki torches. Got tiki torches.
I actually did Google tiki torches. Doesn't work, doesn't do anything for mosquitoes.
Really?
Yeah, the citronella is just like an old wives' tale.
Oh, really? Wow, that's good to know, because that shit smells horrible, too.
Yeah.
So I would gladly tell that to everybody I meet. Duh.
Yeah.
So what do you do for a tiki torch? What do you do for a mosquito now, then?
So the only other thing you can get, which we got, which is there's like a little thing that you charge. Looks like a Nest or a Google Home or something. And then inside of it, there's like a little stick you put in there that has some kind of a spray or so, or like some sort of liquid that... some sort of scent that mosquitoes don't like. And then every so often you see the machine like aerates it and like puffs out a little puff of stuff that mosquitoes hate.
Huh.
And so we got one of those, and it works pretty well, but it only works well for like a very small little area. You have to have the thing like right next to you.
Oh, really?
But I did discover the mosquitoes are only in one part of our yard. Like if I go near my shed, I'm not getting eaten up. But if I'm on my deck where I would normally sit, because it's my deck, it's meant for sitting.
Yeah.
Where you would think I would sit is where I get eaten up. But then I noticed.
Are they hiding under?
Could be under. That's definitely a possibility. other one I noticed is sort of near our deck. There's these weird plants that only grow over there, and they grow sort of like, they're not ivy. I'm sure we didn't get the fanciness of ivy, but there's some kind of plant that grows along a fence. Oh. And I'm like, should I just cut that shit down?
You should chop down everything in your yard and burn your deck.
I'm just going to keep chopping and burning with a machete. It's like until I see that they're gone.
They're the telltale heart of mosquito. I mean, I've been driven crazy by insect before, so I get it.
Yeah.
I would definitely burn a house down over a rat.
Yes.
Let alone if it was infested in flies or excuse me.
Fortunately, we have an invisible force field against all rats and mice, which is the five stray cats.
It's so crazy.
And I'm not talking about Brian Setzer and his orchestra. We have five stray cats that hang out in our yard. You saw them. They're
insane. Yeah. We had a little barbecue, a little Labor Day barbecue. Mm-hmm. Just
we got to talk Labor Day, too.
We do have to talk Labor Day. Almost didn't happen this year.
Yeah, barely even talked about it on this pod, even though it's our holiday that we invented.
Pretty much. Yeah, it's kind of insane. It was so low-key this year that it almost didn't happen, but then it happened with a plum.
Yeah, this was sort of like our get back of, like, you know, things, you know, there was the year where we made, I would say the top year was when we had a new meme every 15 minutes and different memes, I think, on three different social platforms, including plus a video that we had produced, plus a live stream.
Yeah, and that was 298 original memes outside of the video and the live stream.
Yeah.
Last year, it's no surprise to anybody, Labor Day didn't really go off very well last year because of Mark Zuckerberg.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the shame of it is nothing's come in to replace Instagram or Facebook yet.
Yeah. Threads.
Threads. we're kind of shackled to these two things where people know to look for it, but then the algorithm has changed in such a way where you can't see anything we do.
Yeah, this was a rebuilding season. It was very solid. We got a bunch. Don't get me wrong. You got your money's worth, which you paid $0 for. You got everything you paid for.
There was over 100 memes.
Yeah.
But
they were good ones.
They were good ones and new contributors this year.
The only reason I say it's a rebuilding season is because I think we're almost at the solution. Like, we've changed things up in a way that I really do feel like we've made progress. We're almost there because the big move we switched up this year is, or we started this last year, but we expanded on it. Now there is a Labor Day Instagram just there for Labor Days. Then all we do is on the main feed, so you don't get flooded with them, which is kind of the whole point. We're supposed to be annoying you, but...
But we do on the Labor Day feed.
Yeah, that's the thing. But we just reshare a few of them and let you know you can go over there. But the thing is, Zucks, with his stupid-ass haircut, spending all of his year trying to wrestle Elon Musk, doesn't even realize that when you're trying to flood people with memes, you can't hide half of them or more from everybody.
He doesn't realize it. Yeah. I don't know what's so thick in his skull.
He's probably fucking drowning in mud at Burning Man.
Yeah, he doesn't. Oh, baby. That's a whole nother thing.
Yeah.
We got so much to get to today. I mean, it is crazy.
Since we're talking about Labor Day, I just want to say it was a good Labor Day. And every time we finish Labor Day, I get a sort of postpartum depression where
I do too.
You've spent all this effort thinking about memes, and it takes a while to click over into Labor Day headspace. And once you're there, like, everything becomes a Labor Day. Everything anybody says to you, you're trying to turn into a Labor Day. And then the next day when you're just going back and you're in the regular world where there's no more puns.
Yeah, it's really weird. And it's now been a week.
Yeah.
A little less than a week. And I am still, like, we were talking earlier today about Labor Day. Like, mm-hmm. Oh, that's a good Labor Day. And there's a part of me, there's about five or six that went unmade.
Yeah.
Where it was like an idea I had that I forgot, or somebody sent me an idea, but I was already too far.
Yeah.
And because, folks, well, I'm going to give you a window. Let's give a whole window into the process.
Open the window. This is the Labor Day window.
So the window's open here. Generally with a Labor Day, now this year was special because David and I had a little meeting the last time we recorded the podcast, and we were about a week out from Labor Day. And I usually, the way it works is I say, I start making memes, and you and former host who is now deceased, Jeremy, would be like, I don't know. You wouldn't have the enthusiasm, but you always caught it. You always would catch it a little later. So generally the pace of it is I would start making Labor Days a couple months early because I had a desk job, and I would start to click into the gear of it all, and I'd make a bunch, and then David would click in like somebody who procrastinates with their homework. You click in like the week of and make like 100 memes in 3 days.
Yeah.
And then that usually settled us with enough. This time was crazy because we both had to click in at that last minute on high gear.
You were still a little ahead of me, and sometimes what fuels me is jealousy where I'm like, damn, these are all going to be Nate's this year. Okay, I got to get some in there.
It is. It definitely can be that way where it was like, because too, I'll always get that way too when it's, like you made great one this year, Seinfeld.
Thank you.
Among many other great ones, that one was the first that really made me just like laugh out loud. And when I saw that, I was looking at some of my older, shittier ones. Because for me, it takes a little bit to click in.
Yeah.
And I'm really stretching at the beginning. Like, I wish I could off the top of my head. The first one I made this year was Barbean.
Oh, yeah.
With Barbie and Mr. Bean. And it was just like, these two things kind of sound alike.
Yeah, do you have to ease
in? Zeitgeist.
You got to ease in.
Mott the Hoople and Oppenheimer. Like, I was just coming up with whatever I could until I clicked in. And when I saw Seinfeld, I was like, oh, I got to start thinking differently. I got to stop thinking name puns. I got to start thinking actions and verbs.
Yep. Labor Day, it's a very important thing to the loose meat lore, and we hope that you celebrate it. One day, we're definitely making a coffee table book of it.
For sure. And I think it was especially important this year to have done it in the wake of what's happening with AI and in support of the Writers Guild.
Yeah.
just to have handmade 100 or 100 and something memes using our dome, what we know, using downloaded pictures off of Google that we are not paying for.
Mm-hmm. Usually using the logic of if the meme has like two people's names in it, you just take somebody's head and put it on the other person's body.
Yes. And that, I think, is really important in the shadow of what's happening with AI.
It really is, and it really shows that, like, as shitty as we are with Photoshop, we're still better than AI at the moment.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly.
And listen, we got a few submitted memes that were AI, and a few of them were good. But the problem is, number one, I'm learning, like, you know, AI has only been around since March, but like now people have like figured out like what it takes to be good at using AI. Where like I've now heard more than one person tell me like, you gotta know how to prompt. If you do, you gotta know how to prompt right. Because I tried making some with the AI, and it just wasn't as funny as what we do. I'm sorry.
It was one of my ideas was to have us make it and side by side with AI. And maybe we still do that. Maybe we take the ones we made this year on the at Labor Day page.
Yeah.
And we side by side them.
And we'll see how they go.
And maybe it is a prompt thing. But I'll tell you, I'm pretty fucking good with prompts because I have to Google search every PNG I use.
Yeah.
So, you know, if I'm looking up Oscar De La Hoya PNG, I know how to type that and how to spell his name.
Yeah, I'm like a fucking robot.
Because if you AI Oscar De La Hoya PNG, it has to Google search it anyhow.
Man, you know, one day I think what we should do is like, we should do like a John Henry kind of challenge where like we sit down at a computer and then next to us is AI and then we see who can churn out the most Labor Days.
I think we do that. I think we do
that.
He's
a meme-driving machine.
I think we do a special stream on the 2 to 3 month anniversary of this past Labor Day.
Yeah.
For raising money for children or the writer's strike of America.
Yeah, not for children. Come on.
Yeah, let's do it for the Writers Guild.
So let's raise money for adults.
Let's raise money for adults who are better paid than us. Yeah. And then we'll still look, we'll somehow use it to ingratiate ourselves with them.
Yeah, yeah. Let's definitely make sure that the writers of various shitty TV shows are taken care of.
Things that I don't watch. How I Met Your Mother.
Yeah, we'll never get in now that we're bad mouthed.
We should only be fundraising specifically for How I Met Your Father.
Like, yeah, yeah.
We don't have the breadth and scope to fundraise for the entire WGA.
Yeah, I just
want to just pick a show.
Yeah, I just want to make sure that the writers of Young Sheldon are taken care of.
They have what they need in this time of need.
To watch Big Bang Theory and be like, what if that guy was a baby? I don't know. I've never seen Young Sheldon.
Neither have I. I'll tell you though, Young Sheldon gets a laugh. It is maybe the most jokeable TV show. I don't know if it's even still in production.
I have no idea.
But it gets a laugh every night on EIT tour. We never had him on the show, but friend of the podcast, Scott Yakushin, had an amazing Sheldon bit years ago.
Yeah.
You know, lots Live of good only, yeah. Young Sheldon bits born out of the cash grab that is. What if Sheldon was a baby?
I'm glad they still make shows like that. And since we said Young Sheldon, I feel like we should probably say hello. Hey, everybody. Oh, Nate has a look of disgust.
Wow, you make it worse somehow. Not only are we disrespecting the audience by...
Well, now we're disrespecting Young Sheldon by changing the topic.
By changing the topic. Yeah, exactly. We were on a good riff here.
Yeah, we did probably have another 15 minutes on Young Sheldon.
A television show neither of us has ever seen.
Sorry for ending that conversation. Nate, who I just introduced... And I'm David, and this is Loose Lips, and yeah, you're...
And if, maybe the listener is thinking, are they going to do this again? Are they going to argue about the intro again?
Or some people just like the argument.
I think it's worth the argument, because you just disrespected the audience by, ending the topic early, and then B, insisting, 20 minutes in, they know what they're listening to.
They don't know your name.
They know your name? It's David.
Well, now they do. Listen, I think there are certain people who listen. There's probably three camps. There's certain people who listen because they want to hear the intro. The whole time they're just like, where's the intro? As soon as the intro happens, they turn the episode off.
Like people do with Mark Maron.
Yeah. Like me with Mark Maron. I was just like, the intro, as soon as the interview, not for me.
No, thanks.
The first 15, love it.
His petty grievances with Pete Holmes and talking about his cat.
Oh, does he have a feud with Pete Holmes?
Probably.
Okay. Then there's the other camp who they hate hearing an intro. They're on Nate's side. They don't even like that I'm on the podcast, period. They just want their pure Naders, Naders potatoes. They wish he was talking to himself.
Pure taters.
But then there's a third camp that just like the argument.
When you said Naders potatoes, and I know we both signed NDAs, so we can't talk about this.
We signed NDAs about Nate's nickname. Nate's mom made me sign one saying, that's her material. Don't steal it.
I will only bring it up in so much is to say how poorly cast you and I were this past week.
Yeah.
David and I both had a very, very strange Hollywood job this week. Mm-hmm. And can't really say too much about it other than to say there. Well, actually, I can't say anything about it, so I'll go ahead and say what it was anyhow.
Yeah.
They are making a late show with Jimmy Fallon style Twitch stream for influencers and TikTok stars.
Mm-hmm.
And they were testing out the show. And so this week they somehow David and I got hired to play as if we were young influencers and TikTok stars and play along with this television show and the games they developed for the TikTok stars. So they chose to hire two roughly middle-aged white guys to be like, oh, yeah, I know Tyrone 1 or Tyler 1.
So I'm just going to speak about this in a coded way so that hoping that it can still some parts of it be used in the podcast because, again, we signed an NDA. But I will just say we tested a game show that we were just the testees. They knew that when the show is live, it'll feature young people who have large followings online. Some people call them influencers. But there was this sort of annoying thing about the way that show business works where they're like, okay, we brought you all in because you're like really funny and you're good at like thinking on your heads and you guys just like make really good content. You're like skilled comedians. The only problem is when we play these actual games with the young influencers, they're not going to be so quick on their feet. They're not going to be so funny. It's not going to be as entertaining. And it's like, So shouldn't we then be?
Yeah. We're looking, you know, so if you guys could kind of play it as if the only thing you know how to do is take stuff out of a box.
Yeah. Now, so like, for example, you're much more skilled as an entertainer than them, but you're uglier. So you're just there for the test.
Right. You'll do the test stuff. Then we'll launch the actual show.
Which again, it will be worse, much worse, but they'll be more better looking.
They'll be better looking, and more people will know who they are just through osmosis of using Instagram, apparently.
Yeah. But literally, we would be doing things, and then after they'd be like, okay, it's probably not going to go that well when the influencers do it.
Yeah, they would. And one of the times they even prompted, like, one of the things was a vaguely influencer thing that we had to do. We had to do, like, our own version of an unboxing or whatever. Yeah. And after we were doing it, they were like, oh, can we try to do it this time? Like, I know you guys can easily get through this, so instead of trying to make it entertaining, could you pretend like you don't know what to do? Because this is the type of people we're going to have on.
Yeah.
You know, if you could be a little more mush-mouthed and have nothing to say.
Yeah, I mean, I kind of want to see it when it's actually out, because if they have the same challenge as us, I'm sure knowing what the people are gonna be, it's just gonna be like, sup, so like, this is a box, y'all, and like, glizzy, gang.
I'm rizzing up this box.
Oh man, by the way, so.
Wait, what is glizzy? It's a hot dog, right?
Yeah, but it's also like short for fucking a dick, a sucking dick. Because, okay. Like, you know,
so
if
like
you're the
Barack
glizzy.
Barack Obama glizzes a hot dog.
He's a glizzy gulper.
Yeah.
He's the prime glizzy gulper because he can do it in one move. He can do a whole dog, a whole glizzy, if you will.
He gets the old Willem Dafoe.
Yeah. I don't know if you can do it. That's like a foot long. Please just make the cover Obama giving a blowjob to Willem Dafoe. Oh, man, I kind of want to watch that video, the Tucker Carlson interview. Did you hear about that?
No.
Because he switched over. You know, he got fired because even Fox News was like, you're too low for our standards. And then Elon Musk hired him right up at X, formerly Twitter, gave him his own little web show.
Yeah.
And his first big move to, like, get his old audience back was he brought on a 30-year-old... This guy has, like, a 30 years of con artistry behind him.
Oh, really?
He's, like, been arrested for, like, multiple cons going back 30 years. He claims that at some point Obama and him did meth and fucked.
What?
Yeah.
That's the glizzy gulp?
No, the glizzy gulp is just there's lots of pictures of Obama eating a hot dog in one bite.
Oh. Oh. Yeah, but those might be AI photos.
True. You got to count his fingers, though. AI can't do hands.
So that's what we should do as the challenge. Can we Photoshop Barack Obama blowing this guy and eating a hot dog better than AI does?
See, we can. The only thing is because every fucking AI has, like, goddamn puritanical kindergarten standards of like what.
Oh, so we win.
We win by default. Yeah.
Oh, that like, makes me feel even better.
If you mess around with like ChatGPT as long as I have, like they turn down like almost anything that's even cusping on controversial.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh wow. I do know. Yeah, I do remember because I. Excuse me. Sorry, I just burped in the microphone. I was watching some. One of those like Tim Pool type guys or Jeffrey Crowder or whatever. Not Jay Crowder. What's that guy's name? Something Crowder. Steven Crowder. One of those shows where it was like they were really incensed because you couldn't get ChatGPT to say the N-word.
Like, do you think fucking Google or some multinational corporation, they get in trouble for like the like because they had to thread the needle of like what happens when you ask ChatGPT about abortion?
Like, oh, yeah, right.
Yeah.
So yeah, so they were just trying to make like a free speech argument. Like, you can ChatGPT say fire in a hotel room and, you know.
That's like the end of all conservative arguments, which is corporations should be allowed to do whatever they want, except for when they tell me no. I don't like that.
Yeah. And the woke mind virus won't let us say hurtful things to one another. okay, so wait, now I forgot what we were talking about.
Well, we were talking about NPCs, which are the people who, for some reason, being a Glizzy Gulper is a big part of being an NPC. But I've now watched
this show rubbed off on you.
I'm learning. Well, I had to learn a lot about NPCs. I mean, I think all of America did because this thing didn't even exist like 2 weeks ago.
Right.
I mean, maybe it did if you were like in.
But
deep.
It was like a meme. It was like the. Yeah.
This one lady, I can't even remember her name, but she's like blown up doing it. And then, but it became such a thing that other people who are kind of washed up have started to. Like the rapper Lil Pump, who had like a hit kind of 5 years ago.
Oh,
like,
wow.
He started doing, but like the thing is, he's also doing like the Glizzy Gulper stuff. Where
so you have to watch, all this shit has to happen until the point where, Gary Busey does it. And then you know, like, that's over. The shark jump kind of thing.
It's or,
like,
yeah.
Whatever, like, underpaid millennial is, like, handling Gary Busey is like, oh, you should do this now.
Yeah, that's when it's over, or when it turns into a game on Jimmy Fallon's show where you have to come out and do an NPC.
Okay, Roots, play us some music for Glizzy Gulping. NPC Glizzy Gulping.
That's happening definitely to, like, distract everybody from Fallon Gate.
Right. Okay. Yeah.
Which
I don't
know
if is that a topic because I want to talk
is.
About it.
So, at Razor Kamala gives us mediocre takedowns, Fallon and Martin Short. So I will just say,
whoa!
You're the Twitter guy. I'm surprised you haven't heard this or X guy.
X has been harder to use, and I've been exclusively using X to look up different things about the Detroit Lions for the past 3 days.
So I'll give you the rundown on the two journalistic punts.
Okay. That's an interesting take because I'm vaguely aware of the Jimmy Fallon thing.
I've read both articles. Rolling Stone wrote his. Salon, I think, wrote the Martin Short one. Both of them try to be slam dunks. I'm speaking in your language,
sure.
Sports, so you understand. And for me, absolutely fail. First, the first one, which is the Jimmy Fallon takedown, like they interview a bunch of unhappy ex-staffers, and don't get me wrong, like Jimmy Fallon is probably one of my least favorite people. I fucking hate him and would have delighted to see it come out that he's a complete piece of shit, but it just wasn't there. Like, when you read the entire article, the best I can tell is that Jimmy Fallon is mean sometimes, and he sometimes shows up to work hungover or drunk.
And he paid a prostitute to pee-pee in a hotel room.
Yeah. But you can tell that they're exaggerating because, like, they have to exaggerate because they keep having to, like, because there aren't any good juicy details, like, at least when you read the goddamn Lizzo one, like, she was taking them to strip clubs, which is even still not much, but whatever.
It's a little bit of a something.
Yeah.
There's even darker smoke.
Yeah, and trust me, yeah, I'm sure Jimmy Fallon is doing bad shit, but this article didn't have any proof of it. In fact, like, they had to just exaggerate what everyone who worked there felt, where they're like, when I worked there, I had suicidal ideation. It's like, so does everybody works everywhere. Working sucks.
Work does suck.
You worked for Jimmy Fallon. Like, you knew that going in that the shitheel who you're working for is the least. He's just failed his way up to now he runs the Tonight Show.
Right. So it was just like basically a couple moody staffer. And we know he's an alcoholic.
Yeah.
This has been long.
They said there's good Jimmy days and bad Jimmy days. And like when he shows up, he can be very mean and very critical. But then there was one example really where, I guess during a taping, the cue card person fucked up and Jimmy made a joke about it. Or Jimmy said something to the guy. And then Jerry Seinfeld was there and Jerry Seinfeld was like, hey, apologize to that man.
What? Jerry Seinfeld's on the right side of history.
But that, well, almost. And then after the article comes out, Jimmy Fallon was like, actually, that didn't happen at all. That was a complete idiotic twisting of events. What really happened was that Jimmy had a little flub, and then we made a joke about how Jimmy almost never messes up. Jimmy's never not messed up. The whole thing he's famous for is he would laugh through every skit
on
SNL.
Yeah, he fucked up Saturday Night Live a bunch.
Yeah.
He is... I cannot even tell you who it is now. This is how vaguely I remember this. This is another thing that Rolling Stone probably would have published.
Yeah.
Is like, we knew a guy whose job was to get Drew Barrymore and Jimmy Fallon drugs and access during the making of the movie Whip It.
Yeah.
And that was, and I only remember that because, like, it was astounding to me even at the time knowing how taxing a day of filming can be and the fact that Jimmy Fallon was able to stay up all night, like, after hours at a bar to, like...
I thought you were about to say stay up all night thinking up jokes. I was like, whoa.
No, he wasn't thinking up jokes. He was getting, like...
How does the show happen? Because those aren't thought up.
He was getting blackout twisted at the Bronx Bar.
Right. Because
they had made a deal with the Bronx Bar where they would keep the Bronx Bar open till 5 a.m. for him.
Yeah.
And, like, that was, like... Like, of course, and no wonder this guy's... And so now, of course, he's going to get off taping his show at 6 and then party all night and then be kind of cranky the next day.
Yeah, come on, cut Fallon some slack. But actually, to be honest, when I read the article, they've gone through a ton of showrunners. Like, they've gone through 9 different showrunners in 9 years or something.
Yeah.
Which is a bad sign. And some of them seem like fucking nightmares. But he mostly just seems like he's drunk and not paying attention and doesn't know what's going on. It's going more like the Ellen situation where... Actually, she seemed personally mean on top of it, but...
Yeah. Well, I think that's kind of, like... I think all these guys, too... There is an element to which you do have to get yourself in the zone to make the show,
mm-hmm.
right? And not to...
Drunk, you mean.
Yeah, I mean, not to defend anybody who's shitty to their staff members, but, like, I remember it was a big deal that Steve Harvey had, like, a card that he would give.
Yeah.
Like, don't talk to me right now. But actually, like, everybody came out that worked for him and was like, actually, this is helpful.
Yeah.
Because then we can, like, not be talking. Like, we just, if he needs his space, like, we'll just do his hair without, or whatever. Shine his head, buff his head or whatever.
Yeah.
And I feel like, to a degree, like, that's probably the, like, I guess what I'm saying is I want there to be way more dirt before you publish the next Jimmy Fallon article.
I know.
This is just not enough for me.
They missed it. They missed it. It's not there.
Because I didn't even read the expose. I heard about it and then saw that he apologized and then saw that there was no one even saying, like, he needs to retire. Like, apology not accepted.
Yeah.
And once I realized that, I was like, oh, I don't want to read it then. It's probably nothing.
It was, swing and a miss, Rolling Stone. And by the way, you tried to make me pay to read this goddamn article. There's ways around that.
Wait, pay to read? Do they sell it by the article, or do they want you to subscribe to Rolling Stone?
Yeah, like I feel like with their big articles, they know that everyone's going to look at. They're just like, no, these aren't free. You got to, like, actually pay. Maybe you can pay per article, but it seemed like they wanted me to sign up for Rolling Stone.
Well, maybe somebody smarter than me. Maybe someday we have to talk to somebody in publishing.
Yeah,
because I've never understood why there's not just pay $1 to read the article or pay $2 to read the article.
Yeah. I didn't even really look because there's a website called 12 Foot Ladder where you just put in any restricted article and it just gives you the free version.
Oh, well, that's good. Hey, 12 Foot Ladder, thank you.
Yeah.
12 Foot Ladder presenting this segment.
Free ad. The other one, the other shitty takedown.
Yeah, what's up with this? Because I saw a little bit of the Martin Short on X today.
So it was Salon wrote an article, which must have been a fucking slow news day, but this guy just was like, I never really thought Martin Short was funny. And he decided that was enough to be an article.
Really?
And then so he just was like, why have we been letting this guy be in stuff for so long when he's just annoying and he tries way too hard? And then, like, within the article embedded, there's a bunch of clips. And if you click on any of them, they're really funny. And so it's like, you're not really making a very strong argument here, dude.
Dude, that's funny to me because I think it was like probably like 4 years ago because you're a Martin Short fan.
And I understand this guy's argument a little bit because I switched over the years. I used to hate him.
Yeah.
When I was a kid, at least.
Me too. I didn't think he was funny. And then about 5 years ago, I was like, wait a second. Martin Short is really funny.
And I almost get maybe what this guy doesn't get because in this guy's head, Martin Short is just really, really broad. But I think it's hard to even explain, but I think sometimes he's broad in a subtle way.
Yes.
You know what I mean?
Yes. He is broad. Like, he does character work that is really broad that also understands the character better than anybody yes. else. Like, he understands... It's not like he's doing, like, Opera Man. Like,
yeah.
He, like, when he does Frank from
yeah.
the Father of the Bride, like, that is a fully formed character.
Yeah, yes. Like, same with Jiminy Glick. Like, even though it is just, like, one voice that he does, it's not Adam Sandler because there's, like, a weird amount of detail to it.
Yeah. Dude, the thing he does, yeah, I can't remember the SCTV bit where it's like, it's their version of Celebrity Jeopardy.
Yeah.
Only way funny.
I think it's called like Dolts or Dates.
Yeah. Where it's just dumb people playing Jeopardy. The character he does on that is the funniest visually and intellectually.
Yeah.
Like, he's so good in that sketch that he is at all times, even if he's not directly on camera, he's making a face that is funnier than anything else yeah. anybody else is doing. And then when he talks, it's even fucking funnier.
Yeah.
He's so, that bit, the old Christopher Guest bit about him and his brother are the synchronized swimmer.
One of the funniest things ever.
It's so I love hilarious. That. I'm not a very strong swimmer.
I think I heard, too, that skit, I think, kind of led to the Christopher Guest movies, because somehow, like, I think Christopher Guest worked on that skit, and he, like, that was the first time he met Eugene Levy, who he wrote the first one with.
Yeah, Guffman.
Guffman, and yeah.
He wrote the first two, I think, with Levy. Yeah. yeah. It, dude, that, his, it does make me wonder if he and Christopher Guest maybe had a falling out or something, because he's also, Martin Short is in Christopher Guest's first movie, which is not a great movie. I would highly recommend it if you like Hollywood satires, though. It's like, it's called The Big Picture, and it's Kevin Bacon plays like a Sundance filmmaker who comes to Hollywood with all the new offers and stuff and just kind of fumbles his way through
yeah.
early Hollywood. But it's not a mockumentary. It's a narrative picture that is pretty dated, but Martin Short plays his agent and he is so fucking funny.
Yeah. It.
There's just a great sequence where he's like on the car phone trying to drink a coffee. He's like doing like eight things at once. He's like octopus arming, driving a car with his legs on like the 101. And it is so fucking funny.
Yeah.
This is a pro Martin Short podcast.
Yeah, yeah, this is pro Martin Short. And but then weirdly, just like, again, not to be an old man, but I'm defending Martin Short, so of course I am. But like there was articles afterwards because like the first article came out that was just nothing, which is just like, I don't like Martin Short. And then, then there was like all these celebrities spoke up and just said, were like, what are you talking about? Like Larry David was like, Martin Short. Well, Larry David's quote was great. He was like, Martin Short is the funniest person I've ever met. And then he's like, wait, I know a lot of funny people. I shouldn't say that. Just say he's a very funny person. Wait, no. Actually, you know what? He is the funniest person I've ever met.
Oh, that's great. That typifies. Did, like... What is Salon? I mean, Salon is just like a Slate type. Like, what is it? Like, why did that even gain traction? Is it a blog?
They were like, so they were one of the first web-only journalist places, and they were kind of big. I remember early internet where it was like, whoa, they're not New York Times, but they're making think pieces. And, but yeah, it's like if you can't afford Slate, you get Salon. If you're like, Mom, I want Slate. And she's like, we have Slate at home.
We have Slate at home.
They're talking about Salon.
It's so, yeah, I don't even understand. I don't know. The think piece is such a funny idea to me anyhow. Like yeah. the fact that it gains any traction in the modern day. Like,
yeah,
we all know it's a one person thing. And there's contrarians everywhere. It's like reading Armand White and then blowing up the internet. Like, who
yeah.
cares?
Yeah,
like,
that's a really good point. Especially because, yeah, they definitely like they probably have a meeting like once a month about like, OK, what articles is everybody doing? And then someone was like, oh, you know, everyone likes Martin Short. Well, I actually don't. Well, they'll piss everybody off.
Hey, go with it. Run with it.
Yeah.
Maybe Jason Bateman will tweet about it.
Yeah. But then the annoying thing, too, is so there's so many celebrities that came to Martin Short's defense that there was articles that were like celebrities come to Martin Short's defense, but then I was reading those and they actually were even factually more wrong than the other one. Like, at least the guy who hated him got his facts right, but the people defending him were like, I was reading, I think The Guardian or something was like, talking about all the celebrities who were defending Martin Short, and it was like, Martin Short, who was on in 1981 on SNL, developed his Jiminy Glick character, and it's like, okay, first off, he wasn't on SNL till he was on SCTV then. Yeah. Then he was on SNL, and he didn't do Jiminy Glick till like early 2000s.
Yeah.
So
yeah, Jiminy Glick, the basis for Jiminy Glick hadn't even started in 1981.
Yeah.
Have you ever seen the clip of Martin Short on the Today Show with Kathy Lee?
Oh, yes.
It's so funny. Kathy Lee is just like playing it up like she's a huge friend of Martin Short, and she's like, oh, it's been so long. How are you doing? Like, oh, it's so great to see you again. And even if it's just on TV, like, I got to come to dinner sometime with you and your wife. And then Martin Short's like, well, yeah, my wife died about 2 years ago. And she immediately looks like she was shot. She's like, oh.
Yeah. Oh, that was so good. Kathy Lee fucking deserves it.
Yeah, one of the greatest marriages of anybody in show business. How many years now for you guys?
We have married 36 years.
Mm-hmm. But you're still like in love.
Madly in love. Madly
wow.
In love.
Why?
Cute. I'm cute.
That is true. And you make each other laugh.
Okay. We actually, from our patrons, our sponsored patrons at patreon.com/loose lips have given us some topics. Okay, the other ones were committing crimes and brushes with death. I'll start real quick with brushes with death, which is just, there has been a couple times driving in Michigan where I've hit an ice patch and you hit the brake and it doesn't do anything and you slide. And like one time it happened and while my dad was driving, actually we were in Pennsylvania, and while we were driving, my dad hit the brakes over black ice. Our car did 2 full spins, miraculously didn't get hit by any other cars, and then like just went over to the side of the road. And it's always amazing when that happens, because you figure out what your last words would be if you were to actually die. And in both cases, my last words would have been, no! Or,
he said something beautiful.
No! They should have sent a poet. Our car only spanned for like 1 minute, but afterwards the recording on my phone was 18 minutes.
I've had a couple of those. I had one when I was flying to Michigan for the holidays. Something was so wrong with our airplane that we had to make an emergency landing in Grand Rapids, which is like an additional 10 minutes in the air from Detroit. So I don't know what the fucking issue was.
Did you hear the story of the flight that was supposed to go from Atlanta to Spain, and it got turned around about an hour in the air because someone had such bad explosive diarrhea?
And oh my God.
There was videos of it. And like when I first heard that, I was like, how can one person's diarrhea mean that the whole plane has to turn around? But apparently the pilot, number one, said this to everybody, that someone had explosive diarrhea and it's a biological hazard. But the video is so, like, what happened clearly is they tried to hold it in and make it from their seat in the back of the plane, or in the front of the plane, to the thing in the back. And the video is just panning along the whole aisle. There's paper towels laid down and absorbing diarrhea.
Oh my God. That's horrifying. I'm surprised no one threw up.
I know.
I would have thrown up.
And if you would have thrown up, I would have blown chunks.
You blow chunks, I'm going to spew.
Yeah.
That, oh my God, dude. That would, I mean, we talked about literally on the last podcast about cleaning up at the Maple, but like, dude, that would have made me throw up. I would have demanded off the plane. Fuck Spain.
It's funny because the discourse online is like a lot of people being like, why would they turn it around just for diarrhea? But you are clearly on team turn it around.
Oh, turn it around. They'll fly you to Spain a day later. Yeah, you'll get to Spain.
Yeah, we're 1 hour into a 6 hour flight. I'm not doing 5 hours walking over shit every time I go to the bathroom.
Absolutely. Brother, I'm going to tell you this much. I bet you Atlanta to Spain is probably more than 6 hours.
Yeah, I wonder. Maybe like 8 hours?
And even if it is, God, I'm getting 8.5 hours.
Oh,
dude.
My God. Yeah, 7 more hours of sitting in shit.
No, I'm
fuck
not doing
that.
It. No, no, my time, my life is too valuable. the only time I came really close to dying is I accidentally ate a piece of fish.
Ooh.
My parents were like bugging me to go to church. I've already told this story on the podcast, but it's probably been a couple of years. So My parents were bugging me to go to their new church. They thought I'd like this new church. And so finally, I deign on them to go to their church for a special event called Tasting Fest, where they had tastes from around the world. And the very first thing I ate was African. I love that it was just called African cuisine, as if Africa's not just a continent.
Yeah. Like,
but I went over to Africa cuisine and asked them if it was rice, and the woman thought I was talking.
They're like, "Oh, it's rice, man." That's Africa, right?
I think that's Africa. Yeah, yeah, that's Africa. So they, So she says, "Yeah, that's rice," and it turns out it was finely chopped tilapia. And by the time I made it to the hospital, I had lost the use of all my extremities. And when the doctor asked me what happened, I opened my mouth to tell him and no words came out. It was just like a goo, like a big viscous goo plopped out of my mouth. And then I blacked out. I don't remember any of the next 6 hours. I was revived and I'm fine today. But when I was revived, the first thing I said, like, my family is standing around me crying, and first thing I said is, it's kind of ironic nowadays that Katrina and the Waves sang Walking on Sunshine. And my dad said, fuck you, to me. And then then I was fine physically for a while, and I had, like, really serious, like, psychosomatic mental issues after that. Like, I'd be walking, and my foot would stop working, and I would fall. For a while, and then it just went away over time. But it was very scary and very hard to reconcile, I think.
Man, I gotta, because, like, okay, when I go to a restaurant, if I ask, like, hey, is this thing vegetarian, sometimes I'll get an answer where I can tell, like, they didn't really check, they're not 100% sure, they just want me to shut the fuck up, and they'll be like, yeah. And they're like, okay, you answered that too quickly, you maybe you don't know. Or sometimes, like, I can just tell, but I'm like, whatever, if I fucking, there's meat in there, it's not the end of the world. For you, you can't do that. It is the end of the world.
It
You'll
is
die.
The end of the world, yeah. And I'm, like, fairly certain that at some point that will be the end of my life.
Yeah.
But it's fun, like, because you and I one time, when we first came to L.A. just to, like, peep it out before we moved here, like, probably 6 or 7 years before we moved here, because we ended up starting the theater instead, we went to Little Tokyo.
Oh, yeah.
And went to this Japanese restaurant, and the woman, like, assured me everything was cool for me, no fish, whatever. And the chef accidentally prepared the wrong dish. And fortunately, she had the presence of mind to see what I was about to eat. And she ran across the room and, like, knocked it out of my hands. Like, but I could have just died right then. Like, oh, it had just been another.
Yeah, you're having brushes with death every time you're in the supermarket.
Yeah. You get about 30 minutes, though.
Mm.
So it's always
like a mushroom trip, you know? It takes a while to wind up.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. And I now carry an EpiPen. Like, that part of the problem why I almost died was I forgot my EpiPen. So
yeah.
If you're going to church, you got to bring an EpiPen.
Yeah. I would also say, just where I live now, like, people are such bad drivers that I feel like half the time I drive, I'm like, when I park, I'm like, whew, didn't die.
100%. No, I'm definitely in the zone on that. And actually, like, my girlfriend is, like, got her learner's permit because she's never driven before. She's from a big city. She didn't have to. And, like, I'm now thinking in this different way now of, like, how, like, I kind of forgot how fucking dangerous driving is because I've been doing it so long. And, like, especially too, as she's was, like, studying to take the test, she would, like, ask me a thing and I'd be like, oh yeah, it's like this. And she'd be like, no, like, no, yeah, you don't have to stop there. Like, yeah, you do.
you see a cyclist at a stoplight. Gun it up.
No, you want to get around him. You got to speed up. Definitely speed up. Try to just cut in front of them so they know not to pass you.
Yeah, let them know the roads are for cars. Okay.
I know. I'm like relearning how to drive through her. I'm like, oh shit, like, I forgot how to drive, and I'm a pretty safe driver.
Yeah.
So, like, then thinking about the fact that there are people who are even less attuned to that than me.
Yeah.
It's And like pretty much every day, a Tesla or a Mercedes-Benz is attempting to kill me on the road.
Yeah. It's interesting because like where we learn to drive is maybe the easiest version of learning to drive. There's like big, wide, empty roads. Detroit's like one of the best places to drunk drive in America.
For sure.
There's just like, it's just empty. So like, I felt like I had like a good long period of time like honing my skills before I came to LA. And I'm really glad that when I was 16, I didn't have to fucking learn here where like, getting on America's oldest freeway is a fucking disaster. And then there are people here who drive like they want to win driving. Like,
yeah. And there's, because they're, the nearest crosswalks are over a mile away, there are just people jutting out in the street because why wouldn't you? You want to drive, walk a mile?
Yeah.
No, driving here is like abjectly terrifying. And I'll keep you updated as I experience it through somebody else's eyes. But that is definitely a brush with death.
This is just like a weird feeling I had. I think I even said this when we were doing the game show, but it was a weird feeling where I recently, somewhat recently, was laid off from the job that I had that I fucking hated, and it's a lot better.
Yeah.
But right when I was laid off, because I have a backyard and I can, I decided, fuck it, I'm going to live hammock life. I ordered a hammock. But then, because I was laid off, I was like, it's going to look weird if my girlfriend's working an 8-hour shift and I'm unemployed sitting in the hammock.
That's so fucked. And you're right. Like, I would think the same way. Like, I wouldn't do it. And I would think the same way.
I haven't put it together for that reason.
Yeah. But it's so fucked up because you're lucky enough right now to be in between jobs and have the government pay you.
I know.
Like, you should be living hammock life.
You convinced me. I'm busting out the hammock.
Bust the hammock. But also, you know, it will look weird.
And Petra's like coming out of her fourth meeting of the day, and I'm like drinking a Mai Tai.
You got your toes are all curled out. Woo! Listen to Jimmy Buffett for the first time in your life.
Wow, I'm a Buffett head now. R.I.P., dude. She's got depths. R.I.P. Buffett, R.I.P. R. Buffett, Steve Harwell.
Yeah, we lost two miracle party animals.
Yeah.
You know? It was a bad week for partying.
And it's cool too because, you know, a lot of my heroes, once you learn more about who they really are behind the scenes, they aren't who they claim they are. But Steve Harwell, Smash Mouth himself, that guy, he drank himself to death. So
yeah,
he is a fucking...
That is cool.
He's an all-star.
He's an all-star. Dude, So a long time ago, actually, this shout out to, we talk about this podcast probably one out of every 10 episodes, but shout out to Culture Dumps, a podcast that David and I both enjoy. But a long time ago, they interviewed the DJ from the band Crazy Town. And to hear that guy talk about Butterfly, it was poetry, and it made me think about that type of song differently. And it wasn't poetry in the words he chose to use or the way he phrased things.
Or how it sounded.
It was just like, I had never really thought about, like, fuck you. If you think Butterfly is a bad song, which it is, it's still one of the biggest songs in the world. And to this day, it gets played everywhere. And for all of your life, you created something that everybody knows everywhere.
Basically, yeah.
And that is a way of thinking about it that I had never really done before. Like, to me, I'd be embarrassed if I made Butterfly.
Yeah.
But to think that Smash Mouth did that four times.
Yeah.
Like, Walking on the Sun is huge, dude. Maybe three times.
Yeah.
All Star is huge.
Their cover of I'm a Believer by the Monkees.
Huge. And Why Can't We Be Friends is huge.
So four, yeah. Four
times, dude. To be able to have done that is like insane. Like, our rest in fucking power, Steve. I'm glad that you drank yourself to, or I'm not glad you drank yourself to death.
You know, he enjoyed himself. And listen, I'm glad that you had that big concert at Sturgis right at the height of the pandemic. That was cool.
He went real squirrely at the end.
Yeah, well, there was that concert. He was like drunk and he was throwing bread at people.
Yeah. But good on him, dude. Fuck your fans.
Yeah, I know. If you're seeing Smash Mouth and you get free bread out of it, be happy.
And I will say, I was with... When Steve Harwell died, I was with some younger people that are friends, and they didn't think even, like, they were genuinely sad. Like, not like,
wow,
like All Star, like lame song, whatever.
Yeah.
No, they were like, man, that's like the song of our childhood. Like, All Star is a big fucking song.
Wow.
It was huge, man. That's their Hallelujah.
Yeah, yeah. I think it's going to be sung for ages. I can't wait to hear the next interpretation of All Star on the next American Idol.
Rufus Wainwright tribute of All Star.
So don't delay. I count supplies are running out. Allow if you're still alive. 6 to 8 years to arrive. And if you follow them, maybe I'll tomorrow. But if the offer shines, you might as well be walking on the sun.
And talk about taking something you like and just pissing on it and defiling it, but like, there may have been a time when I liked the song Hallelujah, but now there has been so many awful covers of it that is maybe the only Leonard Cohen song I can't listen to.
It's bad.
And I listen to his 80s albums.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Actually, dude, there is a really good article. I'll share it. I'll probably cut this part and just put it in the Patreon chat since it's boring, but I'll share it with you as well. There's a great article recently I read on the blog Defector where it was a guy writing about how do you reconcile not the art from the artist like you dislike, like Woody Allen, but like the art from something that's bad in the art.
Yeah.
And the example that he premises the entire article on is the song First We Take Manhattan, where it's like the sixth song, and then there's the part where the woman comes on. Like, well, and it like it's funny because that has always stuck out to me, but it didn't make me hate the song. But then reading this, like his article did the reverse, and I actually kind of hated the song after that.
Oh shit! Well, okay, it's sort of like how I think it's on Hounds of Love, which is the one that has Babushka, or is that the Dreaming?
Yeah, this is Dreaming.
Yeah, like nearly perfect album. It's just if you. I think Babushka is track one. You always got to just pretend that track one isn't there.
It sucks. Yeah, it really is a fucking bummer when you get something. Oh, dude, actually, let me say this. I'm going to open Fuck You Movie from 10 years ago.
Okay,
but it's
going to
be Fuck You Movies from 10 days ago.
Fuck You Movie from 10 days ago.
Really hot yesterday.
Mm-hmm.
Went and saw Gran Turismo.
Oh, yeah. Dude, I haven't seen it.
It's fucking bad. It's like at half an hour in, Luce turned to me and was like, wouldn't you be embarrassed if you wrote this? Like, how could you actually? And it's right. She was right. It was like, it is so bad. But the driving scenes are legitimately compelling, exciting, exhilarating.
Whoa.
Like, I was like, I wanted to leave about a half an hour into it. I was like, we can probably get our money back. I enjoyed it. Like a 2.5 hour, and I don't even like racing movies. I'm not like a race car guy. I don't care about the video game. And it was a bad movie. It was really horribly written. But the driving stuff was so good.
I could see that. Yeah, the game is also like not the kind of game that I like. Like the game, my friends used to have it growing up, and I would go to his house, and like every time a new Grand Torino or whatever came out, they always look amazing. They have the best graphics, like always the cutting edge of, like they just look incredible, but they're just simulators that are so absolutely realistic that like when you drive it, it's like this has the exact handling of that car. And like that's not the kind of games I like. In the same way where I don't really like NBA 2K, I'd rather play NBA Jam.
Right.
I don't like Gran Torino. Or was it Gran Turismo?
Gran Turismo. Gran Torino is the get off my lawn.
Yeah, I don't like Gran Turismo because I'd rather play like San Francisco Rush or some game where you're just supposed to like have like rocket packs and stuff.
No, I agree with you. It's not really my thing. And that's the whole point of this movie is that the simulator was so good that this guy, it's a true story.
Yeah.
The guy was able to play the game so obsessively and autistically that he then was able to drive real life race driving.
Yeah.
And he did. And the real life guy is actually the stunt driver in this movie. Like it's a whole big thing. They make a big deal. People were crying and clapping at the end of our screening because it was like so moving, but it was weird too. Cause I didn't realize it said it was based on a true story. And I didn't really realize how closely they tied to it.
Mm.
But then it takes this really insane left turn driving. It takes a crazy left turn where he's like trying to qualify for this big race. And then he veers off the road and kills a fan of the driving race. But then apparently that was the real, it was kind of like Clint Eastwood's like 1416 to Paris.
Yeah.
Where I guess in real life, while this guy was trying to qualify, he hit like a weird wind pattern and it blew his car sideways and he hit a human and killed them.
Wow, the video game didn't prepare him for that.
No, and then he had to stunt drive and redo that in real life for this fucking PlayStation movie.
Dude, this is like the fucking Killing Fields.
It was. And then the craziest thing too is, again, because it's a horribly written movie, you're watching and they have to create some drama to it. Outside of the fact that he did kill somebody, but they didn't want to leave the main character moping the whole movie.
Yeah.
So then there was like, have you checked Twitter? There's a new internet campaign to stop sim drivers. And then it becomes this like second class thing where everybody's like, no sim drivers in racing. Oh, look out. Here come the sim drivers. No way. But all of that is to say, it's a horrible fucking movie that is boring every time it's not being driving, and then the driving stuff is, like, great.
So the guy who's in it is the real guy that the story's based on, or no?
He does the driving. The guy who's in it is just an actor.
Yeah.
But then the actor doesn't drive in the movie.
The actor, from the trailer, seems like he doesn't act either.
No, he doesn't act. He's bad. No, and, dude, Orlando Bloom is in it, and they're, like, trying to shoehorn him into movies still because he's a name. But he looks like he's been doing meth for like 20 years. Like, he looks terrible.
Oh, man.
Like, his face is shrunken, kind of.
Yeah.
And he's bad. Like, his acting.
Do you remember there was an Academy Awards one year where Chris Rock hosted and that was Jude Law, where he was making a joke about how Jude Law was like in every single movie. And like, it was annoying, like having to see so much Jude Law. And then I think somebody else came up and they're like, I like Jude Law.
Yeah, Sean Penn. And he was like, Jude Law is one of the finest actors we have. What a fucking weird.
And then Chris Rock won because Jude Law is gone.
Jude Law.
That's the last thing he did.
I don't know, but I'll say this in defense of Jude Law, like Sean Penn. I was walking through Glendale recently, and I saw that they were playing AI, and I went and saw AI on a whim.
Gigolo Jim or something?
And it was perfect. That movie is so much better than I remembered it 20 years ago. It's beautiful. It's maybe my favorite Spielberg movie, and he's really good at Jude Law. He's good in Huckabees, too.
Oh, yeah. You know what? To be honest, Jude Law way better than Orlando Bloom.
Oh, yeah. Orlando Bloom stinks, dude. Yeah. Like, he might have... First of all, he ruined Lord of the Rings for your dad when he went surfing down the steps.
Yeah.
And second of all, he does all of his acting like he's, like, in Lord of the Rings. He's, like, constantly, like, holding his hands up, being like, we need sim drivers!
Oh,
like,
my God.
He's very over the top.
Yeah.
Anyhow, movie sucks. Don't see it. But if you watch, like, the racing scenes, you'll enjoy it.
At The Fugitive gives us Pennsylvania prison escape. Have you heard about that?
No. Dude, I must have been not paying attention to the news.
Dude, this one rules. So this guy in Pennsylvania, he was in jail. They were like right about to transfer him to like a more secure prison where he was going to spend a life sentence because he killed his ex-girlfriend. I'll just say that at the top because for the rest of this, you might be rooting for him.
Sure.
As you should. Anyway, there's video of him breaking out. He does like... There's two walls that are next to each other, so he kind of crab walks out by putting his back against one wall and his feet against the other and kind of shuffling up. And he got up to another level, jumped a fence. There was a prison guard in a tower who didn't see him, who has now been fired.
Aww.
I know.
Yeah, he needs a better job.
And
you don't want to be a guard in a tower.
The guy, this was 11 days ago. He is just somewhere in the woods in suburban Pennsylvania outside of Philadelphia. And last night, he snuck into a dairy farm and stole a van and made it like half an hour, and they've recovered the van. He's still missing.
So he's still out.
He's still out.
Okay.
They had like over 400 cops looking for him. And apparently he once did, he's Brazilian, and one time in Brazil he did kind of the same thing, and he snuck out of a prison there and went missing for a long time. So he's like really good at hiding in the woods. And he's been, the weird thing is, so because everybody has backyard cameras and stuff now, he's been spotted on like 8 different backyard cameras.
Whoa, crazy. But, I didn't think about it. It'd be a lot harder now.
It's a lot harder. And I had just seen the fugitive, so I'm like, this rules, this guy's getting away. but he's like, they've caught him now. Like, he used to have a beard. He shaved. I'm really, I know he killed his girlfriend and everything. And apparently the family in Brazil says they are actively terrified that he might make his way back down there.
Oh, right.
But I'm still rooting for him.
Okay. And, well, everybody's a hero and a villain in their own story.
Yeah, yes, exactly. But like 11 days and like to make it this far and do that much shit and like the ingenuity you got to have.
He should probably just go like, go to a hardcore show, start spin kicking. Like, yeah. Just do whatever you've always wanted to do. I'm assuming that's it.
Dude, yeah, for sure.
Doing capoeira at a hardcore show.
But, it was weird to me, too, because, I'm seeing all this, footage from people's backyard cameras, and knowing that it's, in the suburbs, just knowing that these are probably all, libertarian-ish, the kind of people who, believe that in Q and the fact that, the government's going to take us over, but it's, but you are part of the police state. You have cameras that you volunteer for that.
You cannot reconcile it. Do not get it at all. It is insanity. I know I told a story on the last, but no, I already, yeah, I did tell a story on the last podcast. Suffice it to say, when we were looking up the rules on Airbnbs, it's in the disclaimer you sign to rent the house, I guess, that they can put cameras in any room. they can watch you sleep. They can submit your face into the scanner, to use a proto-martyr lyric.
Well, good news for you is New York just passed a law where Airbnb is effectively banned in New York City.
Good. They should ban it. I know I've been... This has kind of been my talking point for the past year is these fucking galaxy brain tech guys who reinvented every wheel by making the wheel over and over again.
Yep.
And so we've gotten to the point where Airbnb was a bad experiment. Let's get rid of it. Let's go back to hotels.
Yeah.
It's done.
Yeah.
It's
done. In every way, it's worse.
It's worse in every way. Everybody loses their shirts. Only one person gets rich.
Yeah. You lose continental breakfast. You gain someone watches you sleep.
Right. And masturbate. I mean, good on this guy for escaping. I wish that happened more often.
Yeah.
It bums me out that it doesn't happen.
Nearly 2 million Americans are incarcerated in the prison system of the U.S.
Yeah, I think that about does it. Man, one time we had a substitute teacher not want to teach us anything, and he put on Twister, which in school I had to watch Twister, and I also had to watch, I think it was Dante's Inferno, the movie, movie with Pierce Brosnan.
Yes.
Which I've heard that both of those movies are considered some of the most scientifically inaccurate movies ever made.
Dude, Dante's Inferno, probably the reason you had to watch it is because it was in the Clifford H. Smart Middle School English. The screenplay was in the English textbook. Because we had to watch it too, and I remember that specifically because there's a scene of the little boy talking to his grandma about Fugazi in our textbook.
Wow, I did not know there was Fugazi in that. Fugazi exists in the Dante's Peak universe.
In the Dante's Peak universe, and in that universe, it's the only person that listens to is a 12-year-old boy with a backwards cap. He's friends with Zachary Ty Bryan.
R.I.P. Zachary Ty, wherever you are.
Oh, no, he's wigged, dude.
Yeah, what happened? Wasn't there some? What was the most recent?
So he got scammed out of a restaurant.
Yeah,
he had a small chain of wing stores called Big Wangs that had racist signage in the front where you couldn't wear a backwards hat and your pants had to be tight fitting. but then he got scammed out of that. But now I guess he's scamming other people and he's on the run. He's turning into Star Wacker.
Oh my God.
There was a big thing in the Hollywood Reporter where even Tim Allen said he went too far right wing.
Whoa.
And he's turned into a Randy Quaid style figure.
So you mean that people are, the Star Wackers are after him?
The Star Wackers are after him. Yeah, absolutely.
Dude. Yeah, no one, you know what? Mark's fine, so you can have a goth phase and be fine.
Yeah,
so.
You can be fine. You can lose all your money just to a bad marriage.
To an abusive older woman. I forgot he was dating like a woman like 20 years older than him.
Oh, let's do a big announcement. First, for your mom who listens to this show, is she excited? Speaking of Jimmy Fallon, he just announced the first Rolling Stones album in 18 years of new music.
I didn't know that.
And
I should
Charlie Wood plays on his last few tracks on this album.
What the fuck?
We're doing plugs for the biggest band in the world.
And they could use it.
There's also a song with the only two surviving Beatles playing music on it.
What the hell? I'm sure this is going to rip then.
Yeah, it's going to rock.
That's a power. And listen, you know, I've been wondering which direction they're going to go since Bridges to Babylon. So...
Yeah, I've been waiting for them to take that next step. You know, they were really on a crescendo after Voodoo Lounge.
Yeah,
and then
yeah. You know, it's just I'm there like the mixed solo career. That's my kind of jam. But
so yeah, enjoy that, Faith.
Yeah.
And then yeah, I guess we have our own things. Eh?
Oh yeah, yeah. So
well, I'm going to be listening to this Rolling Stones album.
We have our Loose Lips podcast, which Nate should listen to. We have some episodes he hasn't heard yet. Our Patreon, patreon.com/loose lips. We have videos coming out probably at some point. Oh, yeah, yeah. I filmed something at HLP TV that'll probably come out whenever I fucking feel like it.
Hell yeah. Yeah, I want to get back. I'm back in the mix. I want to get back at HLP TV and get some new stuff coming out.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I think that's kind of all we got going for now. I don't know.
It's a quiet period.
It's a rebuilding.
We just did Labor Day.
I didn't even set this up. I wanted to. Okay. Big thing that's going to be ongoing, a new segment for this podcast.
Oh.
I have now watched 100% of the Detroit Lions games this season.
Yes.
And because I have, I'm going to keep that going. And so I've decided I'm good luck. Me watching means
yes,
they
huge.
Win.
They're, big victory.
They beat the Super Bowl champs. I've been informed that does not mean that they are the Super Bowl champs. But in my heart they are. And I'm ready to do it. So I'm going to watch every single football game the Detroit Lions play this year. And we're going to report back and see how we felt about the game. We're going to have the Detroit Lions. Maybe we'll come up with a name for it.
Yeah, yeah. The Lions Den.
The Lions Den. Forward down the field.
Yeah.
We're going to go over something that, you know, I don't know much about. Nate does know a lot about. But I'm going to learn about and watch. Review of first game.
Yeah.
I signed in, ready for my same old Lions. Which was, when you watch a Lions game, at least in my family growing up, it's just all about the schadenfreude. It's just,
yes,
you're just watching them lose. That's what you do. But this was strange because they were kind of killing it and did cool stuff.
Yeah.
And, like, including the running back at one point did a move where he did a backwards. He did 180 degrees. He's facing away from where he's supposed to go. You're like, oh, wrong way, bro. Then he turns it around.
Then he figured it out.
Yeah.
And he turned around.
Yeah.
Yeah, the old Lions, he would have run the wrong way.
Yeah. So they got a new coach, tells them which way to go. Got new plays that seem to be working. But I'm going to be watching this season and giving updates. Game by game.
Game by game. And so, David, the takeaway then is, A, they thrilled you enough to propose this segment. So
yes.
That's great news. As a man who has watched probably 1 to 5 football games in the past 30 years of your life.
Yeah.
What was the experience of the show? Like, was the show good? Was it entertaining? Like,
yeah, it was. And, like, it was just, I like a lot of things about it, I'm realizing. Number one, I like the one game a week. Like, I can definitely put some time aside on Sundays. 3 hours is kind of perfect because it's like, if you drink during it, you're just going to get, like, a nice buzz. 3 hours isn't really enough time to get plastered.
Sure.
I kind of, now hearing that they're 10 a.m. makes me less excited. I might be watching them later. Because what we did the Thursday at 5, I liked.
Thursday at 5 is great. And we'll have another one of those in 3 weeks.
Yeah.
I'm still back on at 5.
I'll still do the, maybe I wake up at 10. I'll find some way if I can get a stream. I promise I'm going to watch them all. But yeah, I really enjoyed it. And to be honest, it's also because, like, as someone who literally only watches football games when they're the Super Bowl, I'm like, wow, this goes a lot fucking faster. Like, in my head, football games are all five-hour ordeals. But, like, when you don't have to, like, stop to, like, announce, like, a new commercial every second and then do, like, an insane halftime show, you don't even get the halftime show in a regular football game.
Yeah, it does play a lot faster. It does. And unfortunately, Dave, I'm looking at the schedule. So we watched the Detroit Lions defeat the Kansas City Chiefs 21-20 in the most thrilling victory of... one of the most thrilling victories of my life. I was losing my mind. I got a little...
I will say, dude, watching with you... Okay, with your watching experience, you are not a Fairweather fan. You will watch every game. But during the game, you're a Fairweather fan. Because in the middle of the game, you're like, that's it. They're done. They lost. They're going to get
over.
It. Why don't we just turn it off? It's over. It's done.
Yes.
And then they would come back a little bit and be like, oh, yeah. And then they'd like be down a little bit and be like, ah, fuck them, idiots.
It was, that's the relationship that I have. I think I don't sit for the probably the last like 30 minutes of a football game. I rarely sit. And then I was so enthusiastic about that game. And to be honest, I skipped dinner. I got a little twisted up. had to walk home and get some cheese bread and get my car later. But I was so thrilled by the win that I just looked at Lions news on Twitter until 10 o'clock and fell asleep fully clothed.
Oh, my God.
I was losing my mind. And I've listened to every podcast about that game since then. So I'm so enthusiastic that I'm furious that they're not going to play until 10 a.m., next Sunday against the Seattle Seahawks.
Seattle, we're coming for you.
We're coming for you. And then, depending, we may actually also have to cover the game against the Atlanta Falcons on the next podcast. So we might have to take notes, David.
Okay. You're talking about this is going to be a two-game podcast by the time
If we do every other week recording, we might have watched, probably have watched the second game and then podcast right afterwards.
Okay.
2 weeks from now.
Yeah. And I'm sure as we go along, I'm going to learn more about football, the rules, and which players I like. I already have a guy I'm rooting for. I call him Amon Duel. Amon, what's his name?
Amon Ross St. Brown.
Yeah, I like that guy. The running back actually surprised me. That backwards move I was a fan of.
David, let me tell you, the word of football knowers is that guy is special and he should have played more than he did.
Yeah, that guy, I like that thing.
Yeah.
So I'm already sounding like an expert.
I like that thing, that backwards thing.
Listen, I'm going to be doing color commentary. Get ready for it.
So, that'll be our new season-long... the Lions Den.
There's only been one game, so if you want to catch up with us, you can watch that one game, and you can just watch along with us.
We'll be doing Lions watch-alongs, and if the Lions actually make the playoffs... No, we won't do it. I wouldn't talk to our fans through that. It's too serious for me. I wouldn't be able to do it.
By the way,
I'll run a live cam, and you can watch me watch the game, but...
It is funny, though, because because I knew I was going to be doing this, I was like, okay, I'm going to try and get some basic info. So I just went on Twitter to see what the general talk was about the last game. And, like, the sports world is so crazy that there is already someone who produced a rap song about how the Lions are going to the Super Bowl that had, like, a million views already. And, like, they won one game.
Yeah, one game. They beat the Kansas City Chiefs, who were missing two of their three best players. But they had their best player.
Yeah.
So.
Talks like a fucking Kermit the Frog.
Yeah, puts ketchup on steak.
Ugh. Yeah. Idiot.
Sicko.
Yeah. Well, fuck him and fuck you. This has been Loose Lips.
Hey. Fuck y'all.
Bye.
Got another first down. We the Lions. We just got a touchdown. We the Lions. We just hit a field goal. We the Lions. We going to the Super Bowl. We the Lions. First game of the season, so you know we had to take. Headed straight to the top. They thought we'd never make. So it's game time, and we got the Kansas City Chiefs. Last game over. Lions win. Kansas City.
They're a man of skin with a got no hips. They're a man of dicks with opinions. Now let's end the show.